Hello, everybody. This is the American Nightmare, Cody Rhodes. We are on my home away from home, my tour bus, which Wheatley American Vodka has wrapped with their wonderful logo, and they've also provided us with some outstanding Wheatley American Vodka here. We're in St. Louis, Missouri. Here's some things I know about St. Louis, Missouri. The Arch is the U.S.'s tallest man-made monument. Another fact that shocked me, being from Georgia, which I thought was a big barbecue capital, you know, Georgia, Tennessee, Alabama, Texas, and the brisket, all that. Come to find out, St. Louis, Missouri, and the folks of St. Louis consume more barbecue sauce per capita than anywhere in the United States, and that includes Kansas City. So hats off to the barbecue fans of St. Louis. Now, typically I would have a really big introduction for my guest. And this guest certainly deserves the biggest introduction. But look, here he is on my bus. I got a question for you right out of the gate.
Who, me?
Right out of the gate.
What's the question?
I got to know, what are you drinking there?
Oh, man. Well, this is the weekly meal, right?
Yeah.
You got a mule?
I have a mule of Wheatley American Vodka.
Well, I thought I would bring my friend. I got a friend mule, too.
So you have an actual mule.
I got a real mule. This is a real one.
Very real. To introduce us to your mules?
Yes, man. This right here is, we're going to call him D-Mule.
Okay.
This D-Mule.
D-Mule.
And that's D-Mule.
D-Mule.
D-Mule, yeah. And right here is my weekly vodka.
What's in
it? Mixed with a little bit of ginger beer.
That's right. That's right.
And lime. You like lime?
Oh, I like lime, and I like you being on this bus more than anything.
I like being on this bus.
Cheers. Cheers to you.
Nah, cheers to us.
Cheers to us for sure.
Yeah, and cheers to the mules.
People don't know the story.
What story?
Our story.
Are you going to talk about that?
Oh
man.
Ronnie, I personally requested for this to happen. And even today, with concerns that you would not find this bus, or even perhaps the right city, I waited patiently. I was so just, I've done everything right to get to this moment with you. I really have. So,
okay.
So that everyone watching can understand, why don't you tell them a little bit about our story and why we do have this unique relationship?
I mean, there's really no story, guys, gals, folks, people. There's no story. Cody and myself, we've been working together a long time, right?
Oh, yeah.
And Dashing Roads, all the gimmicks, right? All the characters you've had, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Like, they all crossed paths with you.
They've all crossed paths with me. And this is when I came back, I guess, 07, 08, and we was married to each other in sort of sense, you know what I'm saying? And
yeah.
I won a lot. You won too.
You won a lot of the matches.
We both won.
So
we're all winners, everybody. We both won. You know what I'm saying? But I won a little bit more. And Cody told me before he escapaded off, and before he came back, he said, "I will not leave this business until you are looking up at the lights and your toes are pointed up." And I was like, why would you do that to me? He said, "Because you've beat me in every character and you broke my mirror that you set me up on." So I can go on and on about this story that we have, man. But upon Cody making his return back to WWE and being the mega man that he is, we crossed paths again.
Yeah.
And he looked me in my eyes and he said, "It's coming." I said, "What's coming?" He said, "You'll see." And this whole time you've been like, you've been nothing but good to me, great to me.
Oh, yeah,
like,
no.
You even told me the bus is like my home. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, make yourself at home.
Make myself at
home,
right?
Patience is a virtue.
Patience, you know? For what?
Patience for, ultimately, here's what you're leaving out. And we just got to give it to the people. Not only did you defeat me, and I believe the lore of it is 42 separate occasions, there's a dissenting opinion online that says you beat me 23 times. I don't ever recall winning a match, but it wasn't a matter of going over, going under, or anything like that. It was the ways you went about it that will forever be stuck in my brain until we get to this ultimate moment. For example, dashing Cody Rhodes first week, brand new jacket, got the mirror on the back. Pretty excited, difficult thing to do. You know how hard it is to get gear made.
Yes, I do. Not an easy thing, right? I do know how hard it is.
So Miss Sandra puts together this great jacket. Here's the mirror on the back. Maybe it's my mistake that I used real glass. And then
you told me to jump on it.
I don't recall telling you to jump on it. I just recall getting in the ring, getting it off, and the next thing you know, you hit me with your finish, and I see you standing there jumping on top of it, shattering the glass.
Look, he told me before I did, he said, hey, you know, it'd be great if you take this jacket off, throw it down, and just jump up and down on it. You didn't tell me that?
I don't recall telling you that as much as... I think you had set me up. You'd further set me up later down the road, though. Where you asked me to whip you with my gloves as Stardust, and it was a very terribly... Optics-wise, couldn't have looked any worse, and you were laughing as it happened. Then you whipped me, then you hit me with your finish, and then I really think...
I thought it would have been a good moment.
I think, and Demuel... Demuel is just... This is adorable.
Like Demuel.
I think Demuel would probably find it funny that you are the only person who's ever taken Crossroads and somehow managed not to bump.
That's a lie. Somehow managed for a long
to pivot
time.
And no. Stay on your feet.
How can you do that? There's no way to do that. I will get booed for doing
this. This is your story. Is your ability... What is it? You've set the standard for 2 decades. Being in incredible shape, consistency, winning a bazillion titles. Do you know how much stuff you have over me?
No, you got more over me.
I got a whole list. I'm not going to get into it, but I got a whole list.
The
majority of it is things that you have accomplished, which congratulations.
Much love.
Kudos to you. I think it's probably important in this moment. We're sharing this drink together. Cheers, by the way.
Cheers, yeah.
Cheers.
I think you're offending D-Mule.
D-Mule? Dude, cheers to D-Mule. Cheers. I think it's important to know that finishing the story for everyone was about...
Oh, finishing the story.
Finishing the story.
I thought you finished it.
Right, was about winning the WWE Championship. Right. Right, that was the finishing story. But if you really...
Congrats on that, dog, by the way.
Cheers, thank you so much. Cheers. I knew you didn't want to come in the ring, though, afterwards, huh? Nowhere to be found?
We'll talk about that later.
We'll talk about it. Yeah, well, so I think people need to know that when you tell this story about me coming back and saying, hey, it's coming, I think they
need... What you told me.
I think they need to know how sincere that all is. If you really know me, finishing the story and doing it in the most satisfying, the dream, right? Ask me, what is your dream in WWE? What do you have to accomplish? What do you want to do next? Oh.
What is it?
Oh, Demuel, the thought... The thought of the thought, the unthinkable of our truth, the unthinkable, looking up at the lights, looking up, not hooking a leg, just 1, 2, 3, and feeling you know in that moment that I got it back, that I got it back for all that you had put me through, all that we've been through together.
That will crush.
We can't. It's not a thing that can happen, because you're a big time fan favorite,
and you're a big time fan favorite.
They love
you.
You
know what I'm saying? Like, bro, you're.
If people want to see just what rock bottom looks like, look at me watching you do John Cena's comeback in the Royal Rumble. All I wanted to do, was get in and break it up. So bad from the first little tackle. I wanted to trip you. I wanted to and I had to sit there and watch it. It happened to me.
You wasn't happy?
I was where I always am in a situation with you. I was outsmarted. I was outsmarted. That's what it was. You knew coming in, here you are, this hero to the people. I'm supposed to be a hero to the people.
You are. The American hero to the people, dog. You can't let them down.
I can't touch you.
At all.
Right?
At all.
Well.
At all. Let's cheers to that.
Cheers.
That's a cheers, yeah.
Off limits.
Off limits,
off limits, you know?
You know, the people. We're the people's people. You know what I'm saying?
What about when we watched Django together?
Did you like that? First time ever, right?
It was the first time I'd ever seen the movie.
Yeah. You watched Django with me, y'all. Yes.
Did you feel that? Did you feel that you made me comfortable, or did you feel you made me
made you very at home, like you did me on the bus? Yes, at home, dog. Yeah. I just wanted to see where you found your funny spots at.
Well, so that's what I remember about it is
what
throughout the film, anytime something uncomfortable would come up, you would look at me to see if I was laughing.
Yeah,
and which made it even more uncomfortable in that moment. But I did enjoy the movie.
You couldn't hold it in, though.
I feel
you
like
were snickering away. You was.
I don't. I think I was just going along with whatever, whatever was happening. But gosh,
you enjoyed the movie, though.
You brought two.
We laughed.
You brought two mules on the bus.
Yes.
The mule, the mule.
D and the.
So are you kind of a father to these mules?
I'm not a father per se. I do a lot of mule watching.
You're a mule watcher.
I'm a mule watcher. You know, like you got some people like yeah. bird watch.
I'm going to ask
dog
you.
Dog watch.
I'm going to ask you about watch. A couple quotes.
Ask me.
I might dislike R-Truth more than anybody in the whole business.
Who that said was, that?
I said that. How do you feel when you hear something like that?
I don't believe it.
No.
Right? I think it's reversed.
Mm.
I think it's the love.
Just know that 42 different occasions I was looking up at the lights while R-Truth was dancing around and celebrating.
I don't believe that.
Well, the internet will tell you it was 23 times.
Maybe, I don't believe that.
Maybe it's exaggerated to a great
it's big
deal.
Time. I think we won even Steven.
Well, I also said this about you. He's an unbelievably great human. Great father.
See, cheers.
Cheers. Cheers.
You know what I'm saying? We daddies.
So, yes.
Papas.
We papas.
Yes.
Tell me. This is the question that you have to have the answer for. There's a famous photo of you and your son from his basketball game where it declared that you were a member of the Judgment Day in the
yes.
in the actual newspaper. How have you found it doing this job, performing all over the world, but then coming home and being a father and being a wonderful father at that?
How do I find what?
How do you find it? Is it easy? Is it hard? Do you know what's the secret to your success?
There's no secret.
Mm.
You just do. You make it happen. You make it work. You make do with the time you are given. You got. You know what I'm saying? Like you can't procrastinate but so much. And being a parent, there's no procrastination. Either you're gonna be one or you're not. Yeah. And I like making my kids proud. I'm proud of my parents. My son's a huge fan, by the way. Have to say that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah. I told him our history, but we'll talk about that later. But yes, man, I just make time when I'm with my family. I try to make the best of it. I try to make the games. I know we miss so many birthdays. We miss so many anniversaries. We miss a lot of stuff. But stuff that we can make, those are the moments that they remember.
Mm.
And that was one of his moments, man. He done made 1,000 points. Scoring, they had done won the conference, so it was like a big deal to him.
Yeah.
And yes, I was declared a member of the Judgment Day by his coach at that time. Yeah.
Do you feel that that was kind of his moment, and then you decided?
Where did this go? You turned it around.
No.
I stole my son's moment.
I'm not saying that. I just
that's exactly what you're saying.
I mean, the spotlight sometimes has a tendency, Ronnie.
Now it's Ronnie. It's not truth now.
I think so.
You're saying I stole my son's spotlight.
I'm just asking you, how'd you feel? You know, you came down there and they made a huge deal out of you, of course. You know, here he is, local hero, global hero, R-Truth. You know?
I was going there to support my son.
Yeah.
For the game, you know what I'm saying? For his scores and stuff. The coach said that.
And your son, is this the son that's a fan of mine?
Yes, Chris, yeah.
So I probably eventually would have to have a conversation with him.
About
what ultimately could happen with you and
no,
I.
No, you're making it seem like I took his like his
no, friend. Not at all. Not oh. at all. It was just I just
threw it out there.
I just wanted to. Demule was curious, you know. Demule was curious. Do you know there's another famous donkey mule in wrestling? I just recalled looking at the two mules you have.
What? Who's that?
So Dick Murdoch and my father in the AWA, this is in the era of you needed to get into fights at the bars so that the fans knew you were tough, and then it would get in the newspaper, all that. They used to go around Minneapolis during their AWA bad guy days, and they brought a mule that they had purchased named Zeb, into the bar, and they had put a Z on its butt. And this is actually one of the reasons they got fired from the AWA as well, because the mule lived with them in the apartment, and it ate up the couch and all the furniture. And this was a Greg Gagne, Vern Gagne provided apartment. So yeah, mules and my family have a unique tie together.
Right. Okay. Do you have a mule?
I do not have a mule. I mean, other than this,
I might have to gift you a mule.
Oh man, how generous! That's what I forget about you, right?
Yeah.
How generous
you see?
You can be.
You got it all wrong, dog. You got it all wrong. First, you're talking about, you know what I'm saying, me and you with the wins. Ain't talking about stealing the spotlight, and now my son can accept a match with us. Ain't no match. We need to tie it together. We need to be a team.
The American truth, huh?
Yeah.
Well, we both are drinking the same thing. Again, thank you to
Wheatley
American Vodka.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Wheatley, yeah.
Cheers to that.
Wheatley bringing people together. You know what I'm saying?
So, here's another question I have for you.
Get to me.
You have your foot in both bodies of water in a sense that you do this medium, you do pro wrestling, you do sports entertainment, but also hip-hop is part of your career. Hip-hop is part of your life.
Yes.
If you had to pick one, which would you pick?
You can't pick one.
No, right?
There's no such thing as picking one.
Mm.
Remember that. Anybody ever ask you that question, there's no such thing as picking one.
Right.
We can't pigeonhole ourselves like that. We have to be able to adapt. Life is all about adapting.
Say this one more time for me. When I say you have to pick one, what did you say exactly?
There's no such thing as picking one.
Wow. I got to be straight with you. That is the coolest thing anyone has said on this show so far, and there's been some really cool things, and one of the wisest things I've ever heard, and it eats me alive that it was you who said it. So I hope we leave this part in. It eats me alive that you just are so damn smart.
You smart too, though, dog.
Not at the level. Not at the.
You are smart, dog. You smart.
I can't see where the puck is going like you. Nobody. You knew I had come back. And one of the reasons, one of the things, people always ask about my return and, hey, did you have any requests? Was there any mandatory things? There was one.
You had a request.
I wanted to make sure that you and I got one singles match. Didn't matter where, didn't matter what. Still hasn't happened, and it can't happen now, you know?
It can't, dog.
Mm. Mm.
The people love us together.
So
we stuck together.
Married, like you said.
Yeah, dog. It's...
So demule, hip-hop, you can't pick just one. You have them both.
The music sets the pace, the tone, man. Stories are told through music. When you go to the ring, they sing your whole entrance. You know what I'm saying? Like, that sets the pace, and I think music sets the pace. We feel, it brings emotion, man. Our characters, your character brings emotion to people. People can relate to that, so they go hand in hand. So you can't pick one. A lot of things in life, you're not gonna be able to just pick one. You have to evolve, you have to adapt and go along with. You have to get into the streams of the river and become that river. Don't try to pinpoint where the puck is going. Feel.
Wow. Wow. So you, in addition to how wise...
I love it, yeah.
How good you can profess and teach, certainly. This is a question I feel like only you could answer as a musician. And I have my answer on it. What makes for a good wrestling song? Good wrestling entrance walkout song?
What makes for a good one? Catching the crowd immediately.
Right?
It has to catch me.
Like a hook.
It has to be a hook. Mm. The right hook that they can relate to.
Mm.
They can feel. They can be a part of.
Right.
They can chant back with you. You know what I'm saying? If you evolve them, it has to be involvement. It goes hand in hand again. You know what I'm saying? They get involved because you're striking that emotion. They can relate to you.
Yeah. I have a better answer than I have. I usually just tell people it doesn't have to be a good song. It has to be a catchy song. More than good. It's got to be catchy.
Catchy is good.
But you're on a whole nother emotional level.
Yeah, because they attach to you then.
You know, I used to sing your song.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah. In the locker room, I'd sing it. You never heard it? I would go along. You know,
oh, yes. I remember.
Yeah, you can get with this. You can get with that. Little bit of heat. Big Ronnie comeback. That was really my life for so long. I got so used to it.
No, man, no. Do you listen to my music?
I have listened to your music before.
Really?
You've occasionally texted me in the middle of the night with it, which... Yeah. Thank you, by the way. Thanks for thank you for sharing.
Did you be asleep?
The last time I got a message from you that was music related, I was asleep.
My bad.
No. I feel like it's meant to be. That's how
yeah, I'm thinking you're up, like, you know what I'm saying? You're hungry, you know what I'm saying? You're grinding for the family, you know what I'm saying? Like,
you're an experienced papa. I'm a new papa. She's only 3 years old. So I go to bed at like 9 p.m.
You taking naps now?
No. I haven't taken an adult nap ever.
That's the problem.
But so naps is
something I should do. Don't be afraid to take a nap, dog. If you see anybody over 40 up after 9 p.m., they took a nap during the daytime.
I have a weird fear that if I close my eyes in the middle of the day, someone's going to get me. I don't know what it is.
Who
is
the boogeyman?
I don't know.
No, dog.
I just have
get
a weird fear that someone's going to jump on me or some. I've never taken an adult nap.
Bro, you got to, bro. It revives you.
Yeah.
You're making 3 days in one.
Do you remember?
From 6 a.m. to 12 p.m., that's one day.
Do you remember a wrestler by the name of Zack Ryder?
Yeah.
Matt Cardona, married to Chelsea Green, who we love Chelsea Green. He takes a lot of adult naps. And I've never.
What you call a lot of them? No, I say one nap.
You need one nap.
Yeah, you don't need no two or three. Now you're getting lazy.
Is that the true secret? Because I'm sure you've seen people put your picture up from 20 years ago.
Right.
Next to your picture of you now. And the consistency, what could you, you've been so wise so far. Thank you. could you tell someone who's getting into this industry where you're traveling almost more than anything, where you literally are, every resource in your body is being drawn on a regular, how do they maintain like you've maintained? How could they even get close? What's the secret?
There's no secret. Everybody else, there's no secret.
Yeah?
Nah, if it's a secret, tell me. I need to know it. I just do, man. I don't let life do me. I do life.
I one time was in a gym with you, Ronnie, right? And a bunch of the boys were in a gym someday, somewhere out on the live event road. And I watched you, as I often do. And you, without warming up, got under a bench with 225 on.
I had already warmed up, Cody.
See a warm-up with 225 on, and you were just repping it out.
I do the same workout from high school. The exact same workout.
That's a little bit of a secret. That's a good ingredient. You do your same high school workout still.
Same high school from 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th grade.
Oh, my.
The same one. For upper body, lower body. When guys say, hey, well, what part of your body are you working today? I don't pick a certain part of my body that I'm working. I just...
What was that impersonation you did? What was that? Who's asking you that? Let's do it one more time.
Hey, what part of your body are you working today?
Who's that? Who is that?
Just a typical guy in the gym.
Typical white guy in the
gym. Exactly. I've heard some black people talk like that too, though. Yeah. Yes, I have. So have. Yeah. The body has too many muscles to work one part, right?
Yeah.
I'm right or wrong. So I do the same workout from high school as of today. Mm. Same one.
With everything that you've done, everything that you've accomplished, which is really staggering. Sincerely, you're beloved.
Oh, much obliged.
When you take a step back and you smell the roses on it, is there another mountain for our truth to climb? Is there another thing you want to do? Personal goal, professional goal, something within WWE?
I'm not done yet, man. I don't like to set things. I just like to do things.
Yeah, I know you're not done. Yeah, I know you're not done.
There are things in the horizon, but that I can speak on and say, yeah. I think that the universe just gives them to you. Like this love I got, the love we got, you know what I'm saying? It's given to us. We just have to do it. We just have to keep doing what we're doing.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there's way more things that's left, yeah.
Who's someone who more of a just curiosity? You've had a lot of partners, a lot of different people that you've been in the ring with, Miz being one, in this current timeline.
Kofi, Xavier, John Morrison, Carmel. I've had a lot of partners.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite? Putting you on the spot.
No, there's no favorite.
Really?
No, you can't have favorites.
Oh, I feel like there's got to be a favorite.
Remember, you can't ever pick one.
Yeah, I get that you can't pick one.
Yeah.
But I feel like you...
Everyone adds his own dimension to my... And I learn from them, they learn from me, and these people relate to us, and it just makes that sandwich, not a sandwich. It makes
sandwich.
that sandwich. Better than the average sandwich. It makes it much better.
Yeah.
More digestible. You know what I'm saying?
That sandwich.
The sandwich.
Good. Well, So you don't have a favorite partner?
No.
Is there a favorite match you've ever been involved with?
I have plenty of those. One of my favorites, can't pick one. One of my favorites, Miz and myself, Madison Square Garden against John Cena and The Rock.
Yeah?
That was one of my high pinnacles.
It's because you beat me to it, right? The Rock match? You beat me to it? Is that what it was? I remember it. I remember that.
I got it before you got there. Yeah.
Yeah, you did. You certainly got there.
But you got the win, though.
Well, I mean, I didn't. Yeah. Rock and Roman still beat me and Seth in our tag, so I'm still looking for the win. Whereas you came in and, you know, that was during that period you were just having a.
It was great.
You were having to step on some people to get up to those high heights. You know?
No, I never. I always stepped around. I always stepped around.
Sure.
Yeah, step on anyone? Nah, I don't do that. Nah.
No?
Nah.
At any point, a guy runs across you in the ring.
No need in stepping on nobody.
Without it just happens right out of the gate into the match.
No, man, no. You don't step on people. You get poop on your shoes.
You would get poop on your shoes.
Yeah.
My gosh, you're just the wisdom is next level. You are currently in this run and for the majority of your career, beloved. Everyone loves R-Truth.
You too, right?
Right? Everyone loves R-Truth. Everyone loves R-Truth.
Yeah, I love that, man.
For that to be real, the connection has to be real. You have to be right. Authentic. They see through it when we're not, or at least they, after a while, will see through it. For you, it's, again, 2 decades. You have set the standard for how a man should be as a person, how a man should be as a professional in our industry. You've done that. What does it mean to you that the connection you have with the fans till this day? You go out. They sing back with you. They engage with you. They feel with you when you're down. They're up with you when you're up. How does that feel? I saw it personally, and I obviously we laughed about it earlier, but I watched it right in front of me. As much as that moment happened to me, I also couldn't deny.
Yeah.
People were feeling it.
Yeah.
People were vibing, and that means you're doing it right.
Right. That's a moment, man. That's a feeling that can never be taken away.
Yeah.
Never measured. Because it's always overflowing.
Yeah.
And I think it keeps you grounded. It keeps me grounded, for one. It keeps me humble. I think that's... They relate to me because I relate to them.
Yeah.
I'm every one of those people out there that's cheering for me.
Mm.
If I'm not every one of them, I guarantee I've been in every situation that I've been in. They know that. They can feel that. You know, yeah. Like you heard the saying, real recognize real. Well, it does. So I think it's just... It's a connection of just reality. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So it's a humbleness. They're into this character because they see themselves.
Yeah.
Just like with you. A lot of people that love...
Well, a lot of people think underneath it all is I'm perhaps an evil individual. Underneath it, a lot of people...
You can be.
Politician, you know.
You've been...
Yeah,
that's a whole different thing.
Go ahead. Feel free. Tell it. You can break it down. Do you think that's the case? You think underneath this?
No, I'm just saying because you wasn't always good though. You just started being good. You came back and started being good. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I didn't just start. I mean, I've been on quite a. You know,
I know.
I feel
but
to you, it feels like I just came back because the match hasn't happened yet. But I've waited for what is it feels like 3 years now.
And now they're invested.
Yeah.
They're invested. Now we believe you.
Mm.
So I think that was just, you had to prove that.
So you don't think underneath it is conniving and evil and any of those things?
No, unless you were like, if you turned on me or something like that, right. Then it would come right. Out to be true.
God forbid.
That would,
God
then forbid it would be like, you would make their assumption true.
Mm.
Right? Am I right or wrong?
You've been right this whole time.
Okay.
And again, eats me alive.
Yeah, but cheers.
Cheers to you.
Yeah, see?
Here's a question. I don't know why I'm qualifying everything by letting you know a question's coming, but I asked this of Bailey, and I feel like it's a good question for this show. So looking at the locker room, you have seen the locker room, and you have the experience of being up the card, down the card. You've done the whole game. When you look at our current locker room, is there anyone in there you see that you think is going to break out, that you think is going to move past the lower to the middle card area, someone that perhaps doesn't even know it themselves? Is there just someone you're a fan of, someone you want to see move on to the next level?
Oh, man, you put me on the spot with that. There are so many. We got, that's a lot of talent back there, man.
Oh, my gosh. Unreal.
There's a lot of talent back there, man. I hate to say this, man. Like, the group that I used to be in, the Judgment Day. You know what I'm saying? A lot of breakout stars. A lot of people haven't seen J.D. McGunna really, really get down. He's, he can really go. Carmelo Hayes, he's on his way.
Yeah.
Carmelo is like, I'm rooting for him.
I like Carmelo a lot.
Carmelo, I'm rooting for him. We got a roster of talent, dog. It's just like the locker room is like, and I don't want to qualify them or classify them as middle guys because they just break our stars in waiting. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Rookies, new. They're in the mix. Young superstars.
But they can go.
Oh yeah.
And they get it.
Yeah.
It's a big difference in like just having the it factor, but you have to get it too.
Yeah. You mentioned J.D. McDonough just now. I want to save a J.D. McDonough story for you. I feel like it's one I have to get off my chest.
And really? You got one?
You being here, I'm going to go ahead and it's either you've made me feel like I got to get this off my chest. But
please.
That I'll save for the end here. I have to ask because again, you said you can't pick. You've got your foot in both different artistic mediums.
Right. Thing.
What was the inspiration in terms of your character has always been linked to hip hop, to rap music. What is the inspiration behind that? And did you feel that was going to be your thing always? Or was it just something that you were so close to and enjoyed so much that it was naturally going to be part of you?
Jack Crockett found me in a halfway house. And when he and I talked, to make a long story short, when he and I talked, I actually turned him down for 2 years. When I became a willing vessel to want to change, to want to do something different than what I was doing, and I had to go a different route, he introduced professional wrestling to me.
Wow.
He took me to 3 WCW shows, and I remember the music hit, and he was a cameraman at the time.
Yeah.
And he was sitting there. Now, this guy was... He did time with me. He watched me rap and dance for the inmates. He saw me work out. He saw me just entertain because I had nothing else to do but time.
Yeah.
So he sit beside me. Ric Flair music hits. Ric Flair's coming down the ramp. He said, you see there? That could be you right there. How you was rapping and dancing in jail. You could be rapping and dancing for all of these people. But your own music, you could be doing that right there. You can dance too. You can mix all that athleticism in with, and you can become this great wrestler. You can invest in yourself, and you won't ever have to ask nobody else to invest in yourself. That was the bridge that was made at that moment.
This was Jackie Crockett, huh? I never knew this.
Yes.
That's beautiful, man.
Yes.
I've tried to make everything somewhat of a joke here in this moment because of, you know, my personal feelings towards you, but my gosh.
Yeah. Jackie Crockett met me in a halfway house, said he never gave back before. I tried to get him to invest in my music career.
Yeah.
And he said, kid, I met you in a jailhouse. Nobody's going to ever invest any money in you. He said, but I never gave back before. And God's telling me to give back to you. It won't cost you nothing but time and dedication. And I was a willing vessel.
That is a beautiful American story.
Yeah, see?
No doubt. Here's a beautiful Irish story. That feel free to cut this out of the episode if you want. If not, it's all good. During my indie run, I didn't always pay attention to what the local independent was doing.
Right.
You just saw it on your calendar, and you go there, and you knew who you were wrestling.
Right.
I didn't know about the ins and outs of the champion of this independent territory. I didn't get any of this, right?
Right.
There's a show in Ireland, independent called OTT. Very popular independent. Very, very well done. One of the best ones that's going. And they promoted me coming there, and I had even seen the month before because it's social media. Now you see it all. Like, they throw my picture up on the screen, the place loses their mind, they make this great poster with me coming, it's me just front and center, you know, like
you're the guy. Yeah,
oh, it felt great. So again, not paying much attention to what's going on and in this situation. Anyways, I got a triple threat match, and in the middle of the triple threat match, and not even in the middle, like near the beginning, and I've spent, you know, to be fair, during this period I had a ring that people would kiss, I've spent about 20 minutes goofing around in the crowd, indying about, just again, we're not under any time constraints. Apparently we were. This referee tells me I gotta wrap it up. Got to go home.
On an indie show?
On an indie show. So now I don't get out that often. I don't think I do. Or, you know, I have. I try to disguise it when right. there's. But I had to tell the guy, I'm like, hey, man, we're going to go home when we go home. Like,
not on my watch.
Also,
yeah.
Other than a triple threat. So I don't know how you expect, like, this to be wrangled either way. So we went on for about another 10, 12 minutes. Got to it. And then I spent good 30 minutes goofing around, glad handing, having a great time, just loving Ireland, loving every bit of it. Came to the back and there was kind of a cold air about it. And I knew something was wrong, but I didn't know what was wrong. I go up into the little locker room they had for me and no one is speaking directly to me. No one, but you could tell sums up.
So,
and then, maybe it's that I was
treating you cold a little
maybe
bit.
It's the ref. Yeah, very cold, very cold. But also they didn't want to go too far, whatever it was. Get home a few weeks later, JD McDonough, who we know and love, gets into a Twitter spat with Brandy, with my wife.
No.
So apparently, JD McDonough, that was his big title match for the OTT championship that night. And because I had gone to the links I'd gone, the public trans leaves at 10:30. So they had completely checked out. We're looking at a quarter of the people that were there compared to the beginning. There was only about a quarter of them left. Everybody had to get on the trains and go wherever they're going there in Ireland. So they missed his big moment. And he was the OTT, the local hero of it. So yeah, we didn't get the chance to really ever discuss it until I crossed paths with the Judgment Day on Monday Night Raw. But yeah, I feel bad to this day. I feel bad to this day. I feel like I owe JD.
Wow.
Yeah. So I'm glad you mentioned him.
That's you. That's almost like you said about with me with my son. It's like you took his spotlight.
Oh, I mean, I didn't know about his spotlight, though. Like, you know,
you
were out there, you know, and he, you know, because did they hit
okay,
you?
You got it. Okay, yes, you got me.
All right.
Oh, man.
So we got two little things we do as we wrap up the Wheatley American Vodka series here on the bus. Two little things.
What we doing?
The first one is a little jingle that our friends at Wheatley American Vodka like. And I want you to watch it, and then I want you to add your own flavor to it.
So good, I drink it. This song right here is the red, white, and blue. You got the taste, and you drink like it too. Wheatley, so good, I drink it.
Wheatley American Vodka is so good, I drink it neatly. If you were to use another term besides neatly, what would you, again, putting you on the spot here, Wheatley's so good, I drink it.
Proudly.
Proudly. I'll take that. We'll take that. Cheers to Demule.
And D-Mule.
And D-Mule, proudly in consuming a Wheatley American Vodka Mule
proudly.
Beer. Again, ginger beer and lime, and of course, Wheatley American Vodka. Thank you very much.
Much obliged.
Last thing.
What's that?
You got to make a team, right? Oh. Your American dream team for you. You got to make a team. It can be of however many, whatever, Demule, D-Mule can be involved. You got to make a team right now in this day and age. Who's going to be on your team?
What kind of team are you talking about?
American dream team, right? You want me to frame it up for you?
What was it, basketball team, football team, track team, wrestling team?
Let's go with a War Games team. Let's go with five. Let's go with five.
Five?
Five guys. You yourself included, and that's a four others. Who's going to be on your team?
Miz.
It's a great choice. Good first choice, too. I'm glad he was the first choice.
Roman
Reigns?
Yeah.
Okay. Great choice, you know.
John Cena.
Okay. Okay.
And Cody Rhodes.
Oh, man. Saving me for last, huh? Right? Oh, man.
Saving best for last, dog.
Will there be conflicts with you and Cena, considering... currently you do the same things?
We do it together.
Oh, well, in unison.
Yeah, bro, he's
concert.
My hero, dog. You know what I'm saying?
He's your childhood hero.
You see him, you see me. You know what I'm saying? Right?
Yep. You see him and
right?
You see truth. Yes.
What's the difference?
No difference.
Thank you.
I'm looking at John Cena right now.
Exactly.
And I'm looking at R-Truth.
Exactly.
It's all one and the same.
Cheers.
Cheers to you.
Boom.
It's a great team. Wheatley American Vodka. This is the one and only R-Truth right here. Thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
Cheers one more time, man.
Cheers.
Cheers to Mule.
Cheers to D-Mule.